Copy of the Open Meetings Act posted on the west wall of the meeting room and is accessible to the public at any time during the course of this meeting. First item on the agenda is the consent agenda. All items under the consent agenda are considered to be routine by the City Council and will be enacted by one motion. There will be no separate discussion of these items unless a City Council member or citizen so requests. First item is item A, approve agenda as submitted. Item B, receive and place on file all notices pertaining to this meeting. Item C, receive and place on file all materials having any bearing on this meeting. Item D, approval of minutes of regular meeting on February 6, 2017, as on file in the City Clerk's office. Item E, approval of Treasurer's Report of Claims in the amount of $474,672.92. Item F, approval of Boswell Report of Claims in the amount of $172,937.64. Item G, approval of write-off of ambulance bad debts. And item H, resolution number 6022, adopting the 1 and 6 year road and street plan for 2017. Any item that a council member wants removed from the consent agenda? Mr. Catlin?
Mayor, I move that all the items listed on the consent agenda be approved, accepted, and ratified as presented.
Second.
Moved by Catlin, seconded by Morgan, that all items under the consent agenda be approved. Your vote, please. And that is approved 8-0. We have no public hearings, resolutions, or ordinances tonight. That moves us to item 6, the public forum. Purpose of the public forum is for the presentation of an item by the general public to the City Council for consideration at a later date. No discussion or action will be taken by the City Council at this time. Does anyone from the council have anything for the public forum from the audience? Right, we'll move into discussion and reports. First is the Engage quarterly report from our executive director, Walker Zulkowski.
Thank you for having me. Sorry this got postponed. I think we're going all the way back to Q4 of 2016, so I've been giving annual reports lately, so I think a lot of you gentlemen were at my 2017 banquet where we went over the 2016 summary. So for sake of time, I'll just hit on our report here. Does everyone have my report? I think I emailed it to Aaron a couple months ago when we were trying to get this meeting set up. So everything in purple should have been Q4, and I'll just kind of hit on my highlights that I jotted down several months ago. So if you have any questions, let me know, but I'll just kind of hit on what was there. In Q4, we did 19 business retention and expansion interviews, so that put us at 78 for the year. I think our goal is 40, so we're well over our goal for the year, but 19 was a pretty good stamp on the end of the year. That's where we get a lot of our projects from, is meeting with our local businesses, our local industry, and finding out, you know, what's going to help them grow and what are they struggling with and how can the state develop programs to fit their needs and what can we do locally to help them continue to be successful. We spent quite a bit of time on our data management. You know, we've transferred over to a new contact management system that runs all of our projects, all of our phone calls, all of our meetings and everything, so that Glennis and I can stay up to date on who's doing what, who's going where, and who do we need to be following up with. And I did make a note on here to follow up from a previous question that I had gotten from Councilman Kerr about MailChimp, and we actually did transfer over all of our email marketing to MailChimp from Constant Contact. So you'd asked me in the past what that was, and now I know because we use it all the time. So that's how we send out kind of our mass emails, and we get our newsletters and things that goes out through MailChimp. So it syncs right up with our new database we switched over to, so it all talks to each other, and we kind of know you know, who opened emails, who's following up through those emails, and we can kind of track with it just syncs really well. So I guess kind of our focus, and you know, since I've come on, is just let's work smarter, not harder. So with MailChimp, with our ProsperWorks, with our contact, that's a lot of what we finished out 2016 was. Probably the highlight from the quarter four of 2016 was the governor's trade mission. Went over to China with the governor, Director Dellinger from DED, and some other delegates from the state. Ryan Dempster was there. Brian Mellage, you guys have worked with, was also on the trip. But our big I guess our initiative for that trip was to visit Worldlawn's headquarters and tell them how much we appreciate their investment. Kind of get to see some of what they have, you know, on a worldwide scale, and it's pretty amazing. I mean, they have a lot of employees and a lot of buildings, and to kind of put in perspective, the Husqvarna building that they bought here, 300,000 square foot. We walked through one of their buildings while we were in China. It was probably a 400,000 square foot building, and they had 12 others on that campus, and they had another campus a few miles away. So massive company. It was great to get over there and see their
business. How many do they employ there, Walker?
About 15,000.
Wow. Okay. Yep.
So everyone drives scooters, and so there's just bays and bays and bays of scooters all along everywhere. So if anybody would be interested, I do have a nice little PowerPoint that I put together. I've tried to give it to as many groups within the community as possible, talking about that trip, how important it is to maintain those relationships with Worldlawn, and really, I think, with just kind of the Nebraska delegation, and being able to spend a week with some of the top executives from around the state and with the governor, it's really important. So I do have a PowerPoint. If anyone would like to give me, to give that to your group, feel free to shoot me an email or give me a call. But it's dialed in, so I can just pull it up and give it whenever. Just as far as other trips, Glennis attended MADSE, which is the Mid-American Economic Development Conference. It's kind of our NEDA, which is the Nebraska Economic Developer Association, kind of the step up where other states kind of get together to network, visit with site consultants, kind of talk about best practices. That's in Chicago in the fall, so Glennis attended that because I was out. I have on here Hatchery. The Hatchery was kind of moving along. You guys probably all know that, but they're getting pretty close now to putting up some structure out there, so that's kind of nice to see them move and appreciate the road that you guys put in, the temporary road. So, also in Q4, we brought in a grant of $2,500 from First National Bank, and their market president, Rich Herrick, came down and had a chance to give him the tour of the community and talk about the things that we have going on and how much we appreciated those dollars. And we used those dollars. This is the second year in a row we've gotten that grant, and we use those for a lot of our small business kind of networking workshops, training workshops and things. So it's good to get that again.
Walker.
Yeah.
On this, I noticed in the next line, you have 18 new or existing businesses, 11 potential new businesses in the planning phase. Now, you concentrate more on the manufacturing and stuff, and Glennis is this what I'm understanding? She's handling the smaller retail businesses in town.
Yeah.
Out of these 11 potential new businesses, how many have we landed?
I don't know exact number. We've probably gotten a handful. I think one example would be Fast Designs. We used Nolan Fast is a new business that's on Court Street right next to Clay Boss Pharmacy. Young guy was looking at starting his own business. He has now a graphic art business right on Main Street. We used him to do our annual report. He would be an example of someone that Glennis kind of helped walk through the process of, here's how you start your business, here's how you do a lease, you know, here's how you get customers. Tall Tree Chasings was another company or another business we worked with. I can get you a list. I don't know off the top of my head, but that's
good. Well, I'd like to have one because it seems like we're getting more emptier buildings down there all the time instead of getting them fuller. And I think the three potential places that are supposed to be working on this, you guys, Main Street, and Chamber, may need to have a pep rally of such or whatever.
Well, so. Very happy.
I know it's hard. I know it's hard.
Actually, no, it's a great point. And you're kind of stealing some of my thunder from my Q1 report of 2017, but we've actually had some conversations with some consultants. And one of the things we learned when we did our housing study was how many kind of, I think, new prospects that brings to the table. Once you do a study, it kind of validates to some of those folks that, you know, you have the numbers that match up. So that's how we've gotten so many of our housing developers. So we've, in kind of conjunction with Main Street, We've met with several site consultants. We've gotten some proposals, or I guess just consultants. We've gotten proposals on that, kind of downtown marketing. We've had a lot of folks interested in downtown housing, but it's kind of the chicken or the egg. Do you put businesses there first, or housing there first? So we're trying to say, how do we market this and kind of develop this entire downtown area? So with small businesses. So we're looking at doing a strategy. Actually, we have a grant going in to help cover some of that study, some of that survey that kind of gives us a direction, I guess, and maybe specific targets to go after for businesses, for housing developers, whatever it is. So, yeah, we're working on that. We understand that. And that's, you know, as we focus on all the folks out in the industrial park, the primary businesses, what do they need the most, this workforce, and how do we attract that workforce? We need more things downtown. We need more things going on for them. So, yeah, we understand how it all fits together. It's not going to happen overnight, but, okay, does that address your question?
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? I guess if you have anything else specific to this, those are probably, I think, my highlights for it. You know, the Q4 is a lot of wrap up and kind of gearing up for 2017. And we've had kind of an influx of projects the last few weeks, so I'm kind of excited to give you the Q1 report, because got a lot of things moving right now.
Questions? Walker, 2016 was pretty successful for us. And there's a lot of things that are carrying over into 2017. What are some of your goals, strategies for 2017?
Well, number one, I think, is to get a couple of these housing projects across the finish line. We've had several developers, and you guys have what they presented to you. So getting some of those up and going, I think, will be very important. We've got a few projects, just recruitment projects that, you know, we're still kind of working on. That's, you just kind of push those along the continuum, getting some of those. I think the thing I just talked about, that kind of downtown study would be very helpful and give us something to work on in 2017, a little bit more of a targeted focus of what kind of businesses do we want down there. And I think with Homestead Monument out there, it's important for a consultant to come in and say, well, what's somebody else that has kind of a tourism feel to downtown? What are the businesses that those folks are going to stop at and spend money at? So who knows what we'll get out of that, but hopefully we have a direction. I think those are probably my focuses at the moment. Okay. And as you guys know, there are a lot of balls in the air, so catching a couple of them would be good.
Anyone else? Anyone from the public? We've got a few members of the public here. Walker, thank you very much.
Thanks, guys.
Next on the agenda is our annual police report. Chief Lang, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Okay, that didn't start out quite the way I thought it would. Bruce Lang, Chief of Police. I'm pleased to present to you our 2016 annual report. Just quickly, some highlights here. Our victim assistance program, we were able to add through a grant another full-time person to work in that, and this is Carrie McGrury, who was named as the Victim Coordinator of the Year in Nebraska, so we're very proud of that program. Serves a lot of victims, usually 700 to 800 different victims each year, which is a really big number. Follow that up with our communications center. You know, we did a little over, about 28,000 calls for service, which call for service is when we send out a police truck or police car, fire truck, ambulance, that kind of thing. And we're still working towards regionalization. The state is pushing regionalization very hard. And so we are right in the mix of that. We're actually used as an example of how to get it started. And so it will be interesting to see as time goes forward. There's some logistical reasons that some of the other counties have not been able to do it, mainly money, and where they use their dispatchers for dual purposes. It makes it hard to just move into a regional situation, but we're still working towards that. Our overall our staffing is stabilized, which is a good thing. We haven't had a lot of new faces for a while, which is really, really good for the community as well as for us. Our canine program is up and running. Our dog is implemented, running full speed. If you've seen Toro, he's running full speed all the time. Young dog, very active, very good. Whenever they test him at certifications, he does extremely well. He's usually one of the best dogs there. Again, much of that program was paid for with donations. We're able to add a patrol car for him. Thanks to Beatrice Ford, we were able to fund most of that through their donations and their kind gestures. Crimes across the board are pretty much down. Property crimes are down. Usually that's can point to something, and break-ins to cars are significantly lower than they were. Could be a couple different reasons. One could be that some of the people that break into cars are in jail and they've been in jail during 2016. Some is increased enforcement, and others is certainly cooperation with neighbors and the citizens that are, you know, kind of paying a closer attention to that kind of thing. So those crimes are down. A couple crime statistics that are up. Our domestic violence cases continue to escalate. It's a pretty significant issue that we deal with every night, and not just some nights, every night. So those are the numbers. Our drug cases are up significantly, and to combat that, we reallocated some personnel to drug enforcement specifically, and so we're focusing really hard in 2017 and 18. We'll focus really hard on the drug issue and try to get a handle back on that. So with that, I'd be more than happy to answer questions that anybody might have.
Questions of the chief?
Ted.
Okay.
First on page 13.
13.
Top of the page. Truancy.
Mm-hmm.
Is that through your school resource officer, or is that actually something that you guys write a citation for?
Through the school resource officer, and they write citations for it, and they do that in conjunction with the county attorney's office. He's got the state criteria, and then they work out a program on what they're going to do and how they handle it. Roger Harris, their county attorney, takes that serious, and so we write more tickets for that probably than we did with other administrations.
Yeah, you're up to 40 last year.
Yeah,
a significant number when you compare it to some of the other things that you write tickets for.
Yep.
And then I'm sure I probably asked you about that before, but didn't stick with me. And then on page 18, mm-hmm. you have animal warnings, ER, and citations. Does that come strictly from your department, or is that from the dog guy?
Both.
Okay, because the number seems really low. Those numbers seem low.
The citations, warnings.
I just think that for the number of animals that you have, the number of complaints that you get in your report, that seems like a low number. Yeah. So I'm not questioning it. I'm just wondering, you know,
why?
Why?
Yeah. Well, you know. You would wonder that because we do have a lot of animal complaint calls. For example, one of the examples is that if your dog gets loose, the first time we round up your dog, you get a warning. Okay, kind of you get that free pass because everybody's dog can get loose, right?
Sure.
And I told them a long time ago. I said we're not writing people tickets because Fido got loose the first time. You know, if it's a chronic problem, then we deal with it more sternly. He does get a lot of animal calls, but he's able to handle those working with people.
Yeah.
You know?
Which I'm way okay with. Yeah. I think that's probably the better way.
Yeah.
To
I mean, yeah, I think I do agree with that as well. I mean,
yeah.
And he does seem to do a good job with that.
Yeah, we haven't had a dog in a long time, but we had one time that, you know, he got loose and they brought him back and they said, you know, obviously he's loose because he still has his collar and his lead on that came out of the ground. Yeah, the whole 20 feet of it he was dragging. So, yeah.
And some places would write that person a ticket the first time, and I just don't think, I think that's not necessary.
Yeah, yeah.
We're not accomplishing what we're out.
No, those are my two questions.
All right, great.
Mr. Claybaugh?
How about on page 10, it's just other agencies up blocked from 2015?
About middle of the page.
Yep. Okay.
$503 compared to $310.
Mm-hmm. Okay, this, remember, these are the calls for service for the whole communication center. So that covers the county, that covers Wymore, that covers Crete, that covers Beatrice, anything that would go through the communication center. So those numbers are going to be skewed mainly from that angle. If the question is, are we assisting out in the county more? The answer to that would be no.
Right.
It's a pretty consistent number. In fact, they assist us far more than we assist them, way, way more. So probably 10 to 1.
Any other questions? Page 11, towards the bottom. I don't know, as we get older, whether our hearing gets worse or sometimes it gets a little more sensitive.
Mm-hmm.
But noise complaints seems to be something that I get queried about from time to time.
Mm-hmm.
Motorcycles right at 6th and Court. The new pickups with the
measles.
Yeah, that.
Exhaust.
It's just, mm-hmm. and the little Dodge Neons, mm-hmm. that they think they're a 600 horsepower vehicle. Or it sounds like it anyway.
Right.
I guess my question is, the complaints are apparently up. Is this basically, when you say noise complaints, is this barking dogs or is this acceleration?
Primarily loud stereos. That would be the primary number. And again, when we did this, we probably weren't as clear as what we should have been. Remember that these calls for service now incorporate the city of Crete with them. For the last 2 years. So, for example, under noise, we have 311 this year and 256 last year when Crete would have been part of that. So some of their numbers are impacting that, and these could be counties as well. But in a general answer to the question is, almost all of these are loud stereos. My neighbors jumping up and down above me in the apartment above me. Very few of them are the proverbial vehicle complaint noise. There's some of them, but not very many.
Yeah.
And we have an ordinance about some of that, and Mr. Butcher can tell you that some of those are pretty difficult to enforce because of the lack of a real standard for that. But having said that, most of these are my neighbor's stereo is too loud,
yeah.
And we go there every day.
Any other questions or comments? I guess it's really concerning the drug increase,
yes,
and also the domestic and child abuse cases.
Right. And
those are the two that are just really stand out.
And I don't know really what to attribute when you have the domestic cases, child abuse, domestic violence cases. There's lots of socioeconomic issues you could bring to the table, but a lot of it has to do also when you have better enforcement, you have increase in numbers. People see that you will investigate those things. They're more likely to turn them in than they maybe would have before, and people are more aware of that. I can assure you that if it's 85 degrees and someone leaves their child in the car at Walmart, it won't be there for more than 30 seconds before someone calls us. If they see someone do something that they think is inappropriate, they don't hesitate to call, which is what we want. So we get there and we can assess them what's going on. So. That's probably as much to do with it as anything. But the drug issue, it's a secular thing. We saw this in the 10 years ago where the meth activity was really high. Now you add the opiate issue that the whole country is facing, and Beatrice is no different. So we see that as well.
Okay. Anything else? All right, Chief, thank you very much.
Thank you.
You bet. Next item is item C, and this has to do with the possibility of a loan between the electrical department in the city of Beatrice, and Tobias, let you discuss it.
Sure. As you guys know, this today started the cleanup of the gas plant down at First and Market Street. The total cost for that project, I think this year, is $2.8 million, somewhere in that price range. The city's share of that's about $700,000 just for the contractor. There'll be additional costs in there for DEQ's oversight and Black & Veatch oversight, some of those things. The city's been setting money aside for this over the last couple of years. We have about $600,000 set aside. So obviously we're going to be short some cash this year. We have a couple of options in front of us. One is the city can pull the funds out of the cash reserves, our own cash reserves, and look to make up that shortfall. The other one is we can look to borrow the money. We cannot bond this item, so that's not an option. We did check. But when we talked about borrowing the money, a thought came up of borrowing it from the electric department. They have about $5.2 million in cash reserves right now. So the idea would be some type of line of credit, if you will, up to about $250,000. That would allow the city to borrow the money from the electric department. There would be all the necessary legal documents approved both by this body and by the Board of Public Works. If you guys were in agreeance, there would be an interest rate set. If the city borrows money, we have a repayment schedule. We'd also have in there that if the electric department needed the funds back, they could basically call that line of credit with 60 days notice. City pays all the money back, goes borrows the money from a bank, and we move forward. So wanted to bring this out to your guys, see what your feeling was. If it was something you liked, Board of Public Works discussed it. They were not opposed to the idea. Again, as long as all the necessary legal documents were in place to make sure that it stayed there. It's not a commingling of the funds. None of those types of things occurred.
I read or understand, at least, there's going to be a difference in interest rates of what electric department's getting now, what they're going to be charging us. Wouldn't it be fair or nice to make it the same?
The difference would be is the electric department right now, their cash reserves are deposited into CDs right. with banks, and so they're not receiving a large amount of interest on those items. So the idea was if you borrow the money, you would borrow it probably a little bit higher than what they're getting in a CD, but probably a little bit lower than what you'd borrow it out on the open market. So that's why the city would win, because we pay a little less interest. They win because they receive a little more interest than they're receiving on their current CD.
Traditionally, a bank is 2% above the CD rate.
I get that, but when you're talking city money to city money, it seems like it'd be a better deal than, oh, we're going to make a little bit more off of you guys because we can.
You could. We just looked at it as electric fund dollars, that enterprise versus the city general fund.
It'd be awful nice if they would loan us the money at their current, what they're making at the bank to have in there.
Possibility.
Ted?
I don't want to borrow the money from the electric department and pay more than what they're earning. I don't want to borrow money from the electric department, period. I have a hard time explaining to people that the electrical department is part of the city and that they simply won't give the money to the city to pay off this piece of the debt when they have $5 million in their bank. And I try to explain that to people and you know, that they're two separate entities and they simply don't get it. And there's a piece of me, after all the years sitting here, I simply don't get it. It's our money, it's public funds. And I understand it, but I would much prefer to take the money out of the general fund and tighten our belt than borrow. So that's where I'm at with it.
Comments from anyone? Bob.
So the line of credit, the $250,000, do you think that's going to be enough at the end of the time frame? In other words, I hate to borrow. Okay, this year we're going to borrow $150,000, and then we sit here in March or February of 2018 and say, oh, gee, we've got to borrow another $150,000. So projected-wise, are we looking at this as, you know, a one-time thing where we've probably seen what the maximum's going to be with a line of credit so we don't have to go back out and get another line of credit and another line of credit?
There will be an additional cleanup next year is what we're projecting down at the gas plant. How big that is and exactly when it occurs is still unknown because we need to get access to that ground from Burlington Northern Railroad, and they currently are not willing to play ball at this point and granting us access. It is possible that you may need additional funds next year, but I don't know the amount because I don't have a bid on what's going to cost to clean it up. I don't know how much we're going to get done this year on the cleanup, how much that leaves for next year, or if it occurs next year or not. That's what I don't know for sure yet. Those are still the unknowns that we're trying to work through. I believe it'll be a smaller amount because the area is smaller, but I can't tell you for sure.
I am opposed to commingling funds between departments and the city of Beatrice. However, as long as there is a loan document in place with a amortization schedule, I think it is fair to say that we can borrow the money from the electric department, make it 1% interest. I don't care what the interest rate is, but I think I would rather do that because of the reserves that the electric department has as opposed to taking it out of the general fund.
Stan.
Rich?
I don't have a problem taking the money from the electric department, except years ago, that was our bank. If Ted and Phil, Petey and I were there, that was our bank. I don't want to get into that process again. If we have to do it to do this, we put an end date on this thing, either this year or next year or whatever, but we don't keep getting into the same habit of doing it year after year after year because it took us a long time to get that stopped.
Well, don't disagree.
Thank you, Toby, for at least bringing it to us and asking us about it because years ago they didn't do that. They just did it.
Rich, I don't disagree, but that's why we need to have a formal document in place.
Like I said,
that shows the repayment structure.
Just as long as it doesn't become our bank.
Stan.
Yes, Phil.
How much money does the electric department need in their reserve? What's their golden goose egg that they make sure they need? You know, is it the 60-day cash reserve? Is it, you know?
When we've looked at it, you're going to want something in reserve to help pay for purchasing power. Because there was a day in the past where you didn't have enough money in cash reserves to pay for your purchase power bill. So you got to make sure you have some of those things covered. You probably need right now somewhere in the area about $4 million. Okay. It's probably what you need. They're about 5.2 today.
So they won't be critical where
no.
This is going to make them a little nervous. If they had a catastrophic event come through, we'd be like, oh, that was not a good thing. Okay, thank you.
I'm still not sure why we have to pay them any interest. I don't like the idea of borrowing anyway, and I don't disagree with you, Rich, that it shouldn't necessarily become the bank, but it's still public funds. So
but the fact, Ted, is it's public funds that are drawing interest through their CDs or their bank.
Okay.
If we just take the money out of there, actually we're not being a good steward to the taxpayers' money because we're taking money that could be drawing interest and using it, and it's not drawing interest.
You know how much CDs are paying right now?
Better than nothing.
Well, and I don't disagree with that, but if we as a city entity have to borrow money, it will be, we have to.
I understand.
I'm not going to argue it. I'm not going to argue it. I've said my piece. I just think if we're going to take money from the electrical department and we're going to pay it back, it should be at 0% interest. We're simply borrowing from ourselves. I'm not going to argue it. I'm not going to lose. I'll lose the argument anyway. So it's going to be very hard to explain to people in the community that you're paying interest to yourself. So that one entity of that belongs to the city has $5 million in the bank. And another entity, the city, needs a couple $100,000, and we have to pay them interest on this side. I understand it. You don't have to try to explain it to me. I just don't. I think if we're going to borrow money from the electrical department, it should be at 0% interest. They are part of the city. They're a public utility as well. So that's where I'm at.
Okay, let's move on. Anybody else have anything? Anybody? I would recommend that we bring this forward to the next city council meeting with some parameters, and we'll discuss those at the next city council meeting. Next item is item D regarding 407 Court, receiving a bid, and that bid's in your packet, regarding the stabilization of the foundation wall at 407 Court. between the two walls, I guess. Who's going to take that?
I'll let Mr. Butcher handle
it. I can take this one. As the council well knows, and the mayor and the citizens of Beatrice, 407 Court was demolished down to the foundation about a week and a half ago by RL Team and Construction. And the only element of the building that we were unaware of at the time of the demolition was the structure and makeup of the foundation of 407 Court itself in relation to both 409 and 405 Court. Due to the nature of the building, the danger of going inside of it and getting down below it to figure out kind of where those structures were, we were unaware of what we would ultimately find and how it would support the other foundational walls once the demolition was complete. And so as RL Team and Construction completed their demolition and they cleared everything out and exposed the foundation of 407 Court, it was discovered that there were two areas of concern when the structural engineer came down to take a look at and do final checks of the site. And King Little identified a 22-foot section that you'll see if you look at the schematic on page 40, the design that King Little did. There's a 22-foot section approximately of which there is no foundation wall next to the structure of 405 Court, and the same goes for the last 14 feet of 409 Court. Everything to the front of that, if you look north there, is supported by additional foundation of 407 Court, and so it can withstand the pressure of, and we have Bob and Eric here from RL Team and Construction, so you can ask them more technical questions about this. But essentially, when they go in to backfill it or to do anything that they need to do, there's concern in these two 22-foot spot and the 14-foot spot that when they go in to compact that, it's going to compress in and out downward and push in the foundational walls of those two buildings potentially. And so what King Little wanted to do was ensure those foundational walls could withstand the backfill. And so there were two ideas that came up. We went through and looked at all the buildings with the property owners and ourselves on site with King Little. And the first recommendation was to go in and actually put basically girders, steel systems, and wood systems built into the foundations of both buildings to support the walls in the inside of the buildings. When we went inside 405 Court, one of the biggest concerns was due to the nature of their gas lines. They run right where all of this girding and all would go, and it'd be a substantial danger and cost to get it to fit in there correctly. 409 Court, not so much a problem in regards to that. And at the same time, Eric Thiemann from Thiemann Construction made the recommendation to King Little that potentially we could look at putting in essentially giant concrete blocks on the outside where it's exposed. And these blocks would fill in rather than using some sort of liquid fill, concrete, liquid concrete. He can describe this. I'm probably murdering this, but I'm doing my best. So, Eric, you want to come up?
Come on up, Eric.
He can talk about his idea. It makes more sense when he talks about it than I do.
Council Mayor Eric Thiemann, 29735 Rural Beatrice, Gage County. No, as we were looking at that, there were a lot of potential things in the way. To brace up on the inside of the buildings, there has to be a member that can take that load on the inside too. And at 409, the floor joists in that last 14 feet, which is also the section that has the basement, are actually held up by a chain and a board. They've rotted out. So that was the major concern on that side. The other side, it would encumber the Black Crow's storage in there, and they'd have to move everything out, and we'd still have to anchor it all. So we thought about, while we were looking at it, we went through both buildings, and what we're trying to get rid of is lateral load. So when you have a mass of dirt, say this is the basement next to one of the areas, you can't stack dirt without something to support it. So you get a lateral load, which is figured by the quotient of the adjacent angle and the hypotenuse. Anywhere you go, your adjacent angle here will be changing and your hypotenuse length will be changing. So your forces against this wall basically vary from, you know, if you figure 80 pounds per cubic foot of dirt, they get higher and higher the lower you go. So it'd be a linear curve basically. The deeper you get, the more pressure there is. as a rule, you can think of a pile. When you stack anything up, it's going to want to fall to approximately a 30 to 45 degree out. Well, that's what the forces do with the loads next to the wall. So King, the structural engineer, wants to take the dirt down to the bottom elevation of the footing, not the bottom of the wall, but actually the bottom of the footing. So the additional loads out here, there won't be any lateral load because of the concrete blocks. There'll be a static vertical stack with no horizontal load. It'll get transferred to the bottom of the footing and then, in theory, shoot below the footing and not interfere with the wall at all. We're not trying to encourage you or anything. Like I say, this is something the structural engineer came up with. We're more here to answer any questions about the two different processes that King came up with.
Questions?
And it was also, I'll just point this out, Derek, in your estimation, looking at the two processes, the one that you proposed here in the bid documents were provided, you believe is the lower cost option as well, which is the blocking.
Right. We looked at King's estimation of what we would need for steel, fabrication. On the 405 side, we would have to offset all the columns because of the line. So you'd have a column, then you'd have a horizontal support that would go up against the existing wall, be grouted and everything, and mechanically anchored there. So you'd have, everything would be offset there already, which already made it more difficult. We priced both options just roughly, and this is the one that seemed less expensive.
I guess the first obvious question, which of these three properties do we own, and why haven't we maintained them if they're in possession of ours? We don't own these, so why are we bothering with foundations they never took care of?
I'll take that question. We ordered the building to be torn down. We do not own 407 Court.
Right.
At this time. We do not own it. It is still owned by the original owner, but it's under our order that we took it down. Once we took it down, we're responsible for it. As we ordered the contractor is contracted with the city of Beatrice, not with the property owner. And so the project is ours. The responsibility is ours.
Ted?
Right. So I have a couple of questions here. First of all, I'm not quite sure why we're having discussions with Tiemann's, because I'm in the camp with Dwight. I think that we as a city, or someone here, I wasn't part of the discussion, but at some point, when the building came down, it was my understanding through our discussions here that we were simply going to get the lot from the owner, from George. I don't know why we simply don't do that at this point and say, we're done, and sell it to Kate, because it's part of the agreement that Radigan's are going to buy the lot from us when the building came down. The building is down. We have an agreement with Kate to buy the lot. We didn't have an agreement with Kate to tear the building down, dig the thing down 20 feet or whatever it is, fix her basement, fix his basement, shore up this wall, repack the lot, get it back to something, and then she pays us for the lot. The agreement was, we're going to take the building down and you're going to buy the lot from us. The building's down, sell her the lot, let the property owners adjacent deal with this. This is not our problem.
The building's down, but the contractual agreement hasn't been fulfilled yet.
Which is my point. I think maybe you missed part of that, Stan. I said...
I think so, Ted.
Okay. Well, it's my understanding that we were going to take the lot, the building down.
It's down.
And at the point the building was taken down, Kate was going to buy the lot from us.
But according to the contract with Tiemann Construction, the contract isn't fulfilled yet.
You got to
put dirt in, compact it. You've got to put concrete aprons on both sides.
I haven't seen that contract. Before I vote on this, I want to see the contract that says that we're going to dig this thing down, reestablish their footings.
This is brand new, okay? Brand new to all of us, okay?
Exactly. Which is my point, okay? The agreement that I agreed to, begrudgingly, was to take the building down and then sell the lot to Kate. The building's down, okay? Get the lot from George. He'll give it to you tomorrow, I'm sure. I haven't had a conversation with him, but I'm sure he'll give it to you. And sell the lot as it is to Kate. I didn't agree to anything else, and I won't vote to spend any more money on it. That's where I'm at with it.
Anybody else? Rich?
I told you guys there was going to be change orders, didn't I? I told you that it was going to happen. The contract said that we were to support the building walls, correct?
Yes.
Doesn't the foundation include the building walls?
It does.
All right. Then it should have been in the contract that this amount of money should have been taken care of with those building walls. That was, and my understanding was, this was the last amount of money we were going to give them. So the building walls, I don't know who's going to have to pay for it, but we've given the money to support the building walls. We should not, and you guys told me, point blank, this is it. Because I asked you about the change orders that would come in. Nope, shouldn't be any, this should take care of it. Now here comes the change order for $14,000 more. Do the contract, fix the wall. We're done with them. I'm voting no. Well, I voted no all along, but no more money for me.
Anybody else?
And that has nothing to do with Bob, you or Eric, either one. You guys have done an outstanding job. I got to give you credit.
Mr. Catlin, I'd entertain a motion.
Mayor, I would move that I would make a motion that we accept the bid of RL Teeman Construction for the stabilization of the foundation walls of 405 Court and 409 Court Street prior to the backfill, and that would be approved, accepted, and ratified as presented.
We're voting on this tonight?
Yeah.
Hold on. Yep. Why? I thought it was just a discussion. We haven't let any public to come in and put their 2 cents worth in on this.
Is there a second to the motion?
Second.
Moved by Catlin, seconded by Claybaugh, that we accept the bid of RL Teeman not to exceed $13,800 for the shoring up of the walls at 405 and 409 Court. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Any further discussion?
Have we approached the current landowners to see if they have any need or want to do some of the work themselves of the 405, 409?
I have not.
Might be worth an ask. I'm sure they're going to say no. Well, why should we pay for
We've contacted in regards to 409. We've contacted the landlord about an issue in regards to the newly exposed wall. And he has informed us that he is going to work with a masonry contractor to fix that wall himself. So in regards to 409, yes. In regards to 405, which would be the Black Crow, Kate has certain things that she wants to pay for and certain ideas that she has. I think Eric can echo that in regards to what she would like to do with 407 Court should she acquire it. And that's what she wants to spend her money on.
Any further discussion?
Rick.
There
isn't one of us here that wants to spend any more money, I'm sure. But if we don't fix this, the structural engineer will not sign off on it. So all that we've done before this is null then. And Teeman's hopefully will able to come through with a little less than this. It's up to $13,800, but we're hoping that we might be able to come through with less than this figure. Because of maybe some new plans that you, or new figuring, I guess, that you had done?
There's a conflict between our measurements and the structural engineers. We have to go off of what he says, but it looks like there is a smaller area potentially than what he measured, so that would take some less, potentially less material. We'd be happy to, of course, reduce it by that, and then you have a lot of money invested in this already. If this goes well for our placement of these, I told the mayor that we would also look at reducing our bid on that, but this would be a as given to us by engineer price. If everything goes in exactly as the engineer says, there were some increases that the engineer asked for, like removing the existing concrete floor by hand. We can't use any equipment on it. We have to go in there and take it out by hand because of potential vibration to the foundation walls. But we would try to reduce it.
Let me ask you a question, Eric. You put these dry slabs in. You said that her basement, that the joists and stuff were rotted through, held up by chains.
That was on the 409 building, the last section of floor.
That's her building.
No.
Am I saying the wrong building?
409.
He's saying 409.
That's a
405 line. Is the Black Crow.
Okay. I'm sorry. Excuse me. Will they push through to hurt that? Because those are dry. They're not set in there. I know they're heavy. But over the years with the expansion and stuff, could that potentially cause a problem to either one of those basements?
The joists that are there currently?
The dry slabs with the dirt pushing, because the dirt will push and those will slide.
My opinion, not as a stamped engineer, but just as a person that works with dirt, my uneducated opinion, I would say we were really careful when we took the building down and we left all the existing foundation walls in place. So we've got an additional wall next to a wall on one side. And next to the Black Crow, there's, say, approximately a 4-foot offset and then another really nice foundation wall. Those are both really good foundation walls. Up there, I wouldn't think there'd ever be an issue. In the rear of the properties, or in the rear of the 407 property, there is only one foundation wall. It's hard to say what would happen there. Dirt's been there a long time. Things seem to want to stay where they are. The structural engineer thinks we need to have lateral bracing there. I guess it's not a very good answer for you, Rich, but
I know
for us to cover it with dirt, we have to have something from Mr. Little that says we can cover this up.
Ted?
Are the two buildings going to sign off on this when this is done?
Once the structural engineer signs off on Tiemann's work, that completes the work as defined in the contract that was signed by all parties, and we are done. That's exactly how it's defined in the contract.
Ted?
I'm tilting at windmills. Eric, I don't have any problem with this bid. And you understand that. I have a problem with, I don't think we should be paying for this.
I understand that.
Okay. When was the last time that we had a conversation with the property owner at 407 about this and when he's actually going to give us this piece of property? When was that?
Probably 6 months ago, if not longer.
Okay. So back to my original point, without paying for their work. If we did nothing with this tonight and we contacted the owner the property at 407 and we simply took ownership of it tomorrow, because I'm sure he would say here. And all we simply do is our contract says that when the building's down, which it's down, the Radigans will buy the lot from us. Have we looked at that? Because it didn't. I get where you're saying, Rich, about this is the walls, okay? But in our discussion, in the discussions that I was involved in, it didn't say anything about base. We didn't have a conversation about basement walls. We didn't have any conversations about refitting the foundation of the buildings. Would I probably voted for it? Probably, because I thought it was a pretty big crap sandwich everybody was taking a bite out of anyway, and I got that. But at this point of it, I feel like I'm being drawn into it and forced into it, and I'm not going to vote for it because I don't think we're obligated to do this portion of it. I just simply don't.
Okay. Anything else? Gentlemen, I'm going to ask for your vote, please. And it's a tie, 4-4, and I'm going to break the tie, and I'm going to go ahead and go along with the bid that Thiemann submitted.
So we got Morgan, Claybaugh, Catlin, Worth, and Cook voting yes.
All right, next item on the agenda is the strategic update. Tobias?
Yes, as you all know, we had a strategic plan done here 6 months ago or so. Again, just time for a kind of a quarterly update. Kind of run through a few highlights. On the environmental section of it, we are currently working with DEQ to get a grant to do a phase one and a phase two study down at the Dempster's property. They approached us about our willingness to do that. It's at no cost to us. They will undertake those studies. We're working on that grant application. Hope to bring it to you at a council meeting in March for your approval. It would be the same grant application that we applied for on behalf of Storecraft to have some phase one, phase two done at that building. So another thing was DTR phase two. As you know, we awarded that program, and it's currently being put together and should be launched here shortly. The Highway Corridor Committee continues to meet. We're looking to apply to DED for a planning grant to put together a plan for the highway corridor from Hickory Road down to about Arthur Street along Highway 77. Should be applying for that one here shortly. And on the retreeing of Beatrice, we've gone around and identified ash trees that are on city property. We've also gone around and working to identify ash trees that are in people's front yards that may or may not be in our right-of-way. Our right-of-way fluctuates depending on the streets, and so we've just identified ash trees in the front yards of people's properties. We're going to work on going back and notifying those people that they have an ash tree that may or may not be on city right-of-way. If it's a tree that they wish to save, you know, they're going to have to start thinking about taking some steps to protect those trees as we move forward, because our plan right now is if they're an ash tree, they're on city right-of-way. Once they start to show disease, we're not going to look to save those. We're simply going to look to cut them down and remove them. So we'll be working with property owners to notify them.
Now, does that tree have to be fallen right there on that property?
Yes. If you read through the guidelines, once you are a quarantined district or area, which we currently are not, if the tree is cut down during the summer months, it has to be burned or chipped immediately. If it's cut down during the winter months, you can wait to do burning or chipping until the summertime. But they have some time frames in that you've got to get it done. You have to do it within the quarantine area. So if we cut it down in Beatrice, we can drive it to the landfill and do the work.
Oh.
But we cannot drive it to Lincoln and have the work done. You got to do it within the quarantine area.
If those trees are on the city right-of-way, we will take them down at our expense.
That has been our practice in the past. If the tree was in city right-of-way, we took them down. Now, obviously, there's a large number of trees, and so we don't want to wait. And all of a sudden, by the way things look, about the 10th year is really when you start to lose a lot of trees. We don't want to wait till year 10 and then have to cut down hundreds of trees at once. We're going to start working on thinning them out a little bit at a time, planting back behind them as we go. It's kind of the plan that we've adopted as we move forward.
Well, I've had a couple of people ask me about that, and I wasn't for sure.
So some of those
what we did, but I couldn't remember.
Some of those we're going to have to look and see who exactly owns which tree where.
I thought it was chipped on site.
We've been checking on that. The information I've received so far is it doesn't have to be chipped on site. They don't want you to drive it a long ways. But I asked, you know, if we cut it down here, could we have a site at the landfill? And they said, yeah, they thought that would be acceptable. At least a place to get it out of town and do the work there. But I'm not saying we won't chip it on site.
I don't know how you'd chip a tree that's 30 inches in diameter and on site.
Yeah.
How'd they make them that big?
Well, they got Lincoln's using a portable tub grinder, I think.
Right.
But they obviously have more revenue than us. But from the information that I read through it, it was similar to the pine wilt.
Yeah.
And it was, and maybe I'm getting the two of them confused because I'd read on both of them, but I thought it was supposed to be done on site, but maybe that was the pine wilt and it's not.
Probably most practical for us is that trees that size, you'll see us take them down in the winter.
Yeah.
So you can transport them.
Yeah.
To get them to tub grinder, burn them if that's what we need to do, and have them removed that way. rather than trying to deal with those and during the summer months?
The only reason I brought it up is I want you to check, because I'm probably wrong, but I thought it was on site.
Okay, we'll do some checking on it and just make sure. Under the community services, one of the things that's listed in there is becoming a certified local government, or a CLG. It is a program that there are probably a handful of communities in the state that have that designation. It opens us up to have some different grant funds available to us. I've been working with Michael Sothern at Main Street on the pros and cons of moving forward with this, exactly how that program would look. I believe we'll probably look to bring that to a work session in the near future, so you guys have a better understanding of what that means and see if it's something you wish to continue to pursue. Again, try to talk about just what that would open those doors or avenues for Main Street and what would be available to them. Infrastructure, one of those is fiber. We continue to meet with companies about just deploying fiber throughout the community. We have not yet been successful in getting that done, but we continue to move forward. It's a big rock, it's a big hill, but we keep pushing every day to try to get that done. It is moving forward. One of the other things I had in there was just kind of coming up with a long-term capital plan. I think your department has done a good job with that. It's budget time again, and so we've really pushed in the look forward in the next 5 years. What do you see out there that you want to do for capital projects, so we can start to line those up? You start to know what your revenue requirements are for the next 5 years. You can start to plan ahead a little bit better. I think they've done a good job on some of those things.
And I'd also like some input from the council, too, regarding budgetary matters this year. If there's something that you think that is necessary that we take a look at, that we can put it into the next biennial budget, why, I would certainly encourage you to come forward.
We got them listed in there. So other than that, there's a lot of stuff in there, but again, as I think Walker hit on earlier, with the engaging economic development prospects and the housing, those kind of things, there are a lot of things we're moving forward. So I want to let you know that this isn't a study we did and set on the sidelines. We are continuing to pursue things and help push things forward.
Okay, any questions of Tobias? All right, since you've got the floor, we'll talk about legislative update.
Legislative updates, the legislature's taking a lot of time talking about filibusters and things like that. Haven't moved a lot of bills forward. One bill that we were opposed to that they did move forward was LB 22, which has actually been signed by the governor. This was a bill that went out and basically found money sitting in different bank accounts and pulled them into the general fund for the state. One of those funds that they went and grabbed some money out of affected our stormwater grants, which is why we were opposed to it. We've been mandated to do certain things for stormwater, and our funding's been cut. And so we're continuing to ask to do more things with less money, and especially in that program. So that was one we opposed, but it's been signed and done. The other one is that's out there, I want to update you on, is LB 95. This is Senator Crawford's bill about some TIF. The league has drafted an amendment. I reviewed it today and sent back my comments on that amendment. To me, it looks like they're trying to find an answer to a question that doesn't exist, but we'll see what happens. Something's going to happen to TIF this season. We know that. We're just trying to minimize what that effect is. The biggest fear that I have with LB 95 right now is as its amendment was proposed or is going to be proposed, is just it really seems to lengthen the time. They want to give notice to the community college and the school and all the property owners before we do a blight study. And then they want to turn around and give notice, a public hearing at P&Z, and then turn around and give a public hearing at city council before the blight study is adopted. And then you'd have to turn around and give notice again before you had a project come through. So by the time you're done, you would really expand this out to about 4 months, maybe 5 months of notice you have to give before you get a project through. My fear is just with economic development, they're fast-moving projects sometimes. People want answers immediately. And if we say, yeah, we can do that, but you got to give me 5 months to get a meeting done, I see that holding things up. So
is this thing in response because of Omaha and them screwing around with the TIF funds up there 4 or 5 years ago?
If you recall, former Senator Jansen, now Auditor Jansen, went out and did an audit this year of some different TIF projects out there. They found a few issues. There are a couple of senators out there who really don't like TIF. That's what it's response to.
But for the most part, 95% of the cities that were using TIF funds were doing it.
For the most part, they didn't find any errors. The ones they did, some of them were pretty minor. that weren't a big thing. At least in my opinion, were not that big of a deal. Some other ones may have been a little more severe or major. But yes, there are some senators that certainly have TIF in their gun sights, and I'm going to see what they can do to address that issue in their behalf. So other than that, is there any particular questions about a bill? We'll try to answer it, but otherwise we kind of just kind of watch them and see what moves forward. As you can tell, there hasn't been a whole lot of movement yet.
How about 256? How does that differ from what our vacant property ordinance reads and compared with the state's?
LB 256, that's the Create a Vacant Property Registration Act. It would actually significantly change ours. It would really limit what we, they would take the scope of our current plan and really shrink it. And so we have, Lincoln has opted out of it. I believe Omaha's opted out of it. And so it'll just be anybody who's not a primary metro class city. What we have asked for is for an amendment that basically says if you already, you can do the Vacant Property Registration Act, or if there's another way that you can adopt a vacant building ordinance, hence the way we did, you can do it that way too. So it basically gives you an option, not a must do it this way. And so that way we could continue to have our program the way it's been written without having to change the scope of it.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Rick?
Can I move back to your report? Is there any new updates on Prairie Gold Homes? On the house, is there?
Well, it's not on the agenda right now.
Well, I'll do it in my monthly report. How's that sound?
There you go. Okay, perfect.
We'll get you there.
All right. Anything else regarding the legislative update? All right. Monthly report, Tobias?
Monthly report, just quick updates. The gas plant cleanup, they started today. They were in the office having a safety meeting when I was down there. So they had quite a lengthy safety meeting. So they must, I mean, they take it very seriously. You're going to see some construction trailers on the south side of the highway near the site itself. You're going to see some construction trailers on the north side of the highway, basically where we collect Christmas trees. They're going to kind of take over that spot because they also need to have a place to mix different water and cement and some things like that. And so they're going to basically mix those where we kept the Christmas trees. They're going to run it in a pipe. It's going to go underneath the bridge and come back out on the south side where the site is located. And so that way they don't interfere with traffic. We didn't have to find a way to get a water main to cross a railroad tracks. It was the easiest way to kind of get through everything. But they're going to start mobilizing here. You'll start seeing them move in this next week. I believe they told the landfill to expect 75 truckloads of dirt, I think, on Wednesday already. And so exactly when they're going to start moving, we're not exactly sure, but they have started. They are mobilizing. You're going to see trees start being cut down on that site. And fence go up because they'll have a safety fence, construction fence, that type of stuff will go up. And
I know this is a dumb question, but can we use that dirt for cover?
Some of it, yes, you can use for cover soil. Some of it, no, you have to bury it. What we've been told is to smell the dirt when it comes out. If it smells dirty, bury it. If it doesn't, use as cover.
Isn't it already buried?
Yes, it's already underground. And it's not bad. I can't wrap my brain around that one, but that's what we've been told to do.
We don't have to line it or anything before we bury it.
No, nope, it'll go on the liner if we bury it, but no, we don't have to do anything special with it. You had a question about the Prairie Gold Home at 1923 Ella Street. As you know, we are still the proud owners of that residence. We did get a call the other day from Prairie Gold Homes indicating that they want to come down and finish the basement. I met with them on site. They went and looked at it. They called me about 3 days later and said that they would be down to start on their dime to finish the basement out of that house because they want to make sure that it gets sold. They want to make sure that we have a good experience. And so they're doing what they can to help us move that project forward. So they are down currently working on the basement to finish those couple bedrooms that are down there, and I think the bathroom as well. So it would go from being a 3-1 to a 5-2, which would help our marketability on that house. And again, they're doing on their dime. The only caveat would be is if we had a buyer come on while they're down there working and the buyer wishes to upgrade carpet or something like that, we'd have to talk about the difference between their standard stuff and an upgrade on the carpet. But that would be the only caveat they threw out there. Other than that, Hannibal Park, if you haven't been out there, those ball fields, they put agri-lime on them last week, put 250 tons of agri-lime, base agri-lime on, put another 250 tons of good agri-lime on top of that. So with 500 tons of agri-lime, they should be good for some softball and baseball here very shortly.
Where will the actual parking lot be? Parking lots.
Parking lots. There'll be what we've got planned are two of them, one east of those ball fields, so between those ball fields and that those row of houses that are over there, putting one there, and then on the west side, putting a smaller parking lot that may hold, you know, 10 cars over there. May have some parking for that stuff to get them closer to those baseball diamonds.
Okay.
Mr. Claybaugh? Yes.
Are we going to, is our asking price going to change then after they do the basement?
I think once it gets done, we talk to our realtor and see what her opinion is as to the purchase price and see if it changes one way or the other. That'd be my recommendation that we do at that time.
Okay. Any other questions? All right. We have a city council meeting coming up on March the 6th at 7 o'clock, and we have a work session next Monday, February 27th. And I'd entertain a motion to go into executive session.
Mayor, I move that the Beatrice City Council go into closed session at 8:10 p.m. for the protection of public interest to discuss real estate.
Second.
Moved by Catlin, seconded by Kerr, that we go into executive session at 8:10 p.m. Your vote, please. And that is approved, 7-1 with party voting against.